Good morning, everyone, and welcome. On this 24th Sunday of the year, we have a powerful, powerful first reading, gospel reading. It's not easy to listen to when Jesus says, if you want to follow him, take up your cross. But at the heart of what we believe as disciples of the Lord Jesus, we know that we look to the cross. I'll talk about this in the homily today. Please stand.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
My dear friends, let us call to mind our sin, and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, and forgive us our sin, and bring us to everlasting life.
Thank you.
upon us, O God, creator and ruler of all things, and that we may feel the working of your mercy. Grant that we may serve you with all our heart. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord God opens my ear that I may hear, and I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help, therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. He is near who upholds my right. If anyone wishes to oppose me, let us appear together. Who disputes my right? Let that man confront me. See, the Lord God is my help. Who will prove me wrong? The word of the Lord. of St. James. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone says he has faith but not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister has nothing to wear and has no food for the day, and one of you says to them, "Go in peace, keep warm, and eat well," but you do not give them the necessities of the body, what good is it? So also faith of itself, if it does not have works, is dead. Indeed, someone might say, "You have faith, and I have works. Demonstrate your faith to me without works, and I will demonstrate my faith to you from my works." The word of the Lord.
From the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus and his disciples set out for the villages of Caesarea Philippi. Along the way, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" They said in reply, "John the Baptist," others, "Elijah," still others, "one of the prophets." And he asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter said to him in reply, "You are the Christ." And he warned them not to tell anyone about him. He began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer greatly and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and rise after 3 days. He spoke this openly. Then Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. At this, he turned around and, looking at his disciples, rebuked Peter and said to him, "Get behind me, Satan. You're thinking not as God does, but as human beings do." He summoned the crowd, and with his disciples, he said to them, "Whoever wishes to come after me must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and that of the gospel will save it."
The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I played high school football in my hometown of Cumberland, Wisconsin. And I loved football. I loved the game. I loved everything about the game, the teamwork, camaraderie. But I still remember the first day that Coach Wistersill sat us all down. It was right before the August two-a-day practices would begin. He said, "Okay, fellas, sit down." And we all took a seat on the grass. And he waited till we were all calmed down, quiet,
And he had our gaze, and he looked us all in the eye and said, I got something important to tell you. Football is hard. And kind of let that sink in. He said, listen, I'm not going to pretend here. We might win some games, we might lose some games, but throughout it all, it's going to be hard. Every practice, you're going to be wrung out. Physically, you're just going to be whipped, tired. If you aren't, we haven't done our job. And at the end of a game, I expect your heart to be wrung out, to leave everything on the field, to give it 110% all the time. I expect you, with your concentration, your cooperation, your commitment to one another, to give 110%. It's going to be hard. And I thought a lot about those words in light of today's gospel reading. Because, friends, let's be honest, life is hard. We know this. And we know this from things that are pleasant and enjoyable to things that are painful and difficult. We know this, anybody out there who maybe they're working for music and they're trying to develop their skills as a musician or an artist, ton of work. We know this for people who put on a theater production, a play, whether you're on stage or behind the screen, it's a lot of work. I think about people who in school would pick when they could take a class, they wanted this teacher, not because it was an easy class, but because this was a great class, you were gonna learn a lot, but you were gonna work harder than you ever imagined. It's one of those profs who demanded your best, and you fought for a C. And if you got that A or B, you knew that you had pulled something deep out of yourself because they demanded it. You worked harder than you ever did in other classes because you wanted to, because you recognized the beauty, the power, the goodness, but it was hard. You think about this when we've poured ourselves into a project or a task to do the right thing for the right reason. We believed in it, and so we gave everything we had to getting it right, getting it done, and making sure that other people saw the good work. And of course, we know this in relationships, friendships, family, where we give it all to help that person. Time of need, time of crisis, uncertainty, circumstances, we just drop what we do and we help them, because that's what we do, even when it's hard, inconvenient, difficult, challenging. If life is hard, then we understand then that there's some reason behind this, that there's some reason for the pain and the effort and the total commitment and the sacrifice. Because, friends, often we see the pattern that through facing the hard things in life, we grow, we become more, we develop new skills, new capacities, new abilities, we develop new wisdom and insight and learning, appreciation and understanding. We don't grow when it's easy. We grow when it's hard, and we face it. Not run away, face it. To look at the difficulties of life head on and say, okay, take a deep breath. Not sure how this is going to go, but I'm going to give it my best to face the hard thing. One of the things in the spiritual life, when we talk about the hard, we call it a cross. And Jesus says in the gospel today, if you want to follow me, take up your cross. Take up whatever that difficulty, that pain, that suffering, that hardship, that sacrifice is. Take it up and now come after me. Carry that cross. Don't run away from it. Don't hide from it. Don't pretend it's not there. Grab it and go. That to take up our cross means that we have to understand that if we're going to draw near to Jesus Christ, we're going to know very intimately about crosses in this life. That the closer we get to Jesus, the more we're going to learn about the cross. He gives us the example. He died on that cross for our lives. And he makes it clear that as his followers, we're going to carry our crosses too. Spiritual life demands it. It's not because God wills suffering. God doesn't look for people to be in pain, but suffering becomes a focal point through which we understand and come to learn new things, by which we grow, by which we discover how we are called to be sons and daughters of the Most High. Suffering is one of the ways that we learn more and more about who we are and how we interact in the world. Now we know this. And we know that we're going to be taking up our crosses. And some people might say, I don't want to do this. I can't do it. I can't do it. But you know what, folks? We can. And you know how we know is this. Just look back in the past. Look at the crosses you've had to carry in the past. You live this life long enough, it's not just one. We get different ones throughout life. Different challenges, different obstacles, where literally we say, I don't know how I'm going to do this. I don't know how I'm going to make this. I don't know how I'm going to get by. And yet, we understand when we look back that through God's grace, through good people, through the strength we have in Christ, God gives us a grace to carry the crosses that we've been given. And if we can see that in the past, then we can look at the crosses that are before us right now, and we can say, all right, Lord, this is what you've given me, and this is what I need to carry if I'm going to take the next step in the journey. That from the past, we understand how God has worked in our life. And so from that understanding, we can see that God is working now, and God will continue to work. The Lord walks with us. The Lord hasn't left us, but the Lord will give us the grace we need. That begs the question, what's your cross today? Today. What is it that we got to deal with today? What is it that we're facing? What's the hard thing? What's the struggle? What's the trial? What's the difficulty? Just what is it? We just name it. Acknowledge it. Call it what it is. And then second, link our cross to the cross of Jesus. Make the connection. He carried a cross. He told us we're going to carry crosses. So once we've named the cross of the day, then we put that cross before his. Because folks, he triumphed over his cross. He's victorious over his cross. He carried it. He faced it. He endured it for us. And then he triumphed over it. And as we anchor our crosses to his, we anchor our hope that as he triumphed, he will give us the strength to do the same. We carry our crosses. We do so with hope that God walks with us, that God teaches us through the difficult and hard moments in life so that we will, as his sons and daughters, reach full maturity to love, forgive, serve, to express joy and peace. That as we take up the crosses we've been given, we grow in grace. So we can share the love that God has for us with those around us. Whoever wishes to come after me must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. God bless you all. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We offer this day our prayers for our needs and the needs of the world. For the church, her leaders, and all the faithful, that all may be blessed with wisdom and devotion, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
that those who hold public office will imitate the goodness of God, who is just and sustains those in need. We pray to the Lord that the dignity of human life will be protected by our laws. We pray to the Lord that the Lord will bless all husbands and wives and all who are preparing for marriage and assist marriages that are in trouble. We pray to the Lord that our parish may grow in faith, hope, and love. We pray to the Lord for the grace to conform our thinking to God's thinking in all that we do. We pray to the Lord for all our priests in the Diocese of Superior will be on retreat this week. For a time of spiritual renewal, we pray to the Lord. For the intention of this Mass, Jerome Felton, we pray to the Lord. And finally, for all of you at home, as you join us here at the Cathedral with your prayers, for the prayers you have listed in the comment line, and for all of us, for the prayers we now offer in silence. We pray to the Lord. Gracious and loving God, look kindly upon us. Hear the prayers we offer now, spoken and silent. We make them all in the name of Jesus, our Lord. Amen. O God, we earnestly ask you to bless our diocese with many priests, brothers, sisters, and deacons who will love you with their whole
Pray, sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, our loving Father. Look with favor on our supplications, O Lord, and in your kindness accept these, your servants' offerings, that what each has offered to the honor of your name may serve the salvation of all. Through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for you placed the salvation of the human race on the wood of the cross, so that where death arose, life might again spring forth, and the evil one who conquered on a tree might likewise on a tree be conquered, through Christ our Lord. Through him the angels praise your majesty. Dominions adore and powers tremble before you. heaven and the virtues of heaven and the blessed seraphim, worship together with exultation. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in humble praise as we acclaim. Through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. By the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles, glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant, Francis our Pope, James our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned here before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. And there we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress and useless worry, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you in my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Thank you.
May the working of this heavenly gift, O Lord, we pray, take possession of our minds and bodies, so that its effects and not our own desires may always prevail in us, through Christ our Lord.
I'd like to invite everyone to be seated for some announcements. Once a year, we invite members of the Society of St. Vincent de Paul to speak with an invitation to join them in service to the poor. This time I'd like to call up those members to do that.
Good morning. My name is Lynn Tracy, and we are here this morning to invite you to consider membership in our society. What is our society about? Well, it's about the spiritual growth of its members, it's about abiding friendships, and it's about taking up the call to serve those in most need. This fall is an exciting time for us as we transition out of the Catholic Charities building into a new space with a renewed commitment to serve people in our community. We continue, even with COVID, to be contacted by over 1,000 households a year. We're grateful for the support and resources given to us by the Catholic Charities building over the past 15 plus years, and we're looking at renewing our and reinventing ourselves as we move forward into the future. We invite you to grow with us as we make this transition.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Pam Dawson, and I'd like to tell you a little bit about myself and the society. I've been a member for about 18 years or so. I was in a place that I wanted to do something more hands-on in helping people. I heard that the society was doing a talk, and that I thought, I'll give it a try. During these years, I have found that the society is more than hands-on. It has become a family, helping me with my ups and downs of everyday life. It is with this family that we can work together to help those that need. We pray, we ask God to guide us to be able to help those that are in need of our help. I know that I made the right choice when I say my evening prayers, and I can thank God for all the people that He has blessed me with. I know that that is right. Come join our family to see what God has planned for you. God bless.
So as Catholics, we're called to serve. In the letter of St. James this morning, we heard about that we're called to faith with works. And I know for myself, the call to serve the Society of St. Vincent de Paul has given me an opportunity to tangibly serve the suffering Christ, to actually see the face of Christ in those in need, and it also challenges me to imitate Christ because I am to be Christ for them, and I am to be the person who is serving them and serving Christ. So do you think you might be being called to serve? Do you think Christ might be asking you to reach out to those who are in most desperate need? And if that's the case, we invite you to learn more about the many opportunities to serve those in need in our community. We have two options this year. One is on Saturday, September 25th at 5 p.m. at St. Francis Xavier Church in their garden room. And then the other opportunity is Sunday, September 26th at noon here at the Cathedral in Crest Hall. There'll be a light meal at both gatherings, so you can choose which one fits your schedule. Pam and I will be in the back, and if you'd like to leave your name and number, we can contact you whether you're going to be coming to that gathering or if that is not a good opportunity for you to learn more about how to serve. We can't do what we do without your generous support, and we're very grateful for the support that you've given us throughout the years. It means so much to us, and it means so much to have the support of Father Andrew and the priests here at the cathedral who continue to support us and help us to serve those in most desperate need. So thank you all. God bless each of you abundantly, and God bless those who are in need in our community. Thank you.
As I bring the camera back, I owe a debt of gratitude to the members of the society. Lynn mentioned, even with COVID, over 1,000 households a year. Many of them start with a call to the parish office. They see me in person. There's no way I could even begin to help that many people with the other things on my plate. If it wasn't for the society, many people would just go without need in our own community. I'm certainly grateful to those of you members of the society who are out here today, and those of you maybe watching. One other word about this. I know how helpful it's been in our corner of the world. For those of you watching online, learn more about the local Society of St. Vincent de Paul in your own area, community. Consider the good work that they do, and maybe you want to be a part of that work in your own home. It's a powerful way, as Pam said, to get very hands-on, to see the face of Christ in those in need, and to be able to help them directly. Sent out a mailing this past week throughout the entire cluster, so if you're a registered member, you'll hear more about religious education and the Alpha course. We're going to be starting that up soon, and so all the details are there, and also you can find it in the bulletin. Today, you don't have to cook. Go to St. William's Church from 11:30 till about 4:30 in the afternoon, 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and eat this beautiful harvest meal. Ham, meatloaf, mashed potatoes, carrots, and all the garden fixings. I had mass there last night after the crew had done all the work prep. Smells really good. Want to encourage you to go. Home-cooked food, beautiful dinner. And the folks at St. William's had to offer a sacrifice last year because they couldn't do their dinner because of the COVID chaotic, crazy concerns. So you can have takeouts if you need that, or you can dine in. But it's a beautiful day to go for a ride outside just 2 miles to the west of Patterson Park, the St. William's Church, and grab a great church dinner. Across the diocese, we were invited by Bishop Powers to take up a voluntary special collection for disaster relief. In this country, multiple dioceses with hurricanes, fires, tornadoes, floods, and earthquakes. A lot of people in need, and so the bishops are going to use Catholic Relief Services, Catholic Charities of America. Now, there's special envelopes that we have scattered around in the church. Folks, here's the deal. If you want, you can put something in that, and that money is going to go. It'll be forwarded to the diocese, and that's how that'll go. And if you don't have anything on you today and you want to just do something, take the envelope and bring it back as soon as possible, because we need to get this money onto the diocese. But let's pray for those around the country who've just had a whole lot of heartache with natural disasters. Next Sunday, our annual Catholic Services Appeal. That message will be video cast, and so we'll have that in all of the churches. And for those of you online, I'm just going to take the camera back into the sacristy while the video is going on, and we'll talk a little bit about the CSA, and I'll give you a little homily for the readings for that week. I also want to just remind people that adoration at the cathedral is from 1 to 3 o'clock on Thursdays. People are welcome to stop by, have a moment to pray, a little quiet, little silence as they talk and listen to the Lord Jesus. For those of you at home, please keep sharing these masses on Facebook. If you'd like to get a copy of it, you can either go to my website, studypraiserve.com, or you can put in your search engine, Catholic Inspiration Podcast, and you can find them on whatever source or platform you use. We have one parish and a former parishioner funeral announcement this week. I was informed on Friday that Barb Milroy passed away down in the Hudson area. longtime parishioner here, she and Phil, here at the cathedral. Those funeral arrangements will be down in Hudson. The funeral will be on Thursday at St. Patrick's Church. Bev Lundgren passed away. Her funeral arrangements are as follows. The funeral for Bev Lundgren will be on Friday at 11 o'clock here at St. Anthony's Church in Superior. For Barb Milroy, Bev Lundgren, and the repose of their souls. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord. May they rest in peace. May their souls and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.